In today's class, I will be talking about structure of proteins and amino acids. With this, I will start sharing my slides. देखते बच्चों स्क्रीन वेरी गुड बस बस वेरी गुड ওইটা প্রবলেম উইথ সিসকো ওয়েবএক্স দেন ওকে সো হোয়াট আর বেসিক্যালি অ্যামাইনো অ্যাসিডস অ্যামাইনো অ্যাসিডস আর দ্য দে আর দ্য বিল্ডিং ব্লকস অফ প্রোটিনস সো ফ্রম ব্যাকটেরিয়া টু হিউম্যান Bacteria, they are made up of the same set of 20 amino acids. They are made up the same set of 20 amino acids from bacteria to human. So, whatever be the species, whatever be the organism, whatever be in this living world, there are 20 standard amino acids. So, there are 20 standard amino acids. I'll just take a bit of a lighter color over here. Okay. So whatever be it, there are 20 standard amino acids. 19 of these are known as alpha amino acids with a NH3 plus group and a carboxyl COOH group. So they have got 19 of them have got NH3 group and a COOH group to attach to a central carbon atom. And this central carbon atom is known as the alpha carbon atom, C alpha, because it is adjacent to the carboxyl group. So, let us, this is the structure of an amino acid. Ek tu hazy asche, but you can see it, I hope. So, this is the NH3 group here. And this is the carboxyl group here, COO minus group. And you have another R group here and an hydrogen atom attached. And this carbon here, this is the alpha carbon. Because it is attached next to the carboxyl group. Ever, let us see what is... dextro D and L, you have read about what is D and L carbohydrates. Now how D and L amino acids are done. In carbohydrate you had seen that the OH, which is further away from the aldehyde or ketone group, whether the OH is on the right, then it is D. If the OH is on the left, it is L. Okay, so the carbonyl carbon further away, the chiral carbonyl the carbon which is further away from the carbonyl group. So in glucose it is number 5. So that is essentially the chiral last carbon chiral carbon, and that if the OH is on the right, then it is D. If the OH is a D, dandike, L, left. So by this the OH right or left, the one which is further, you can say that's D or L. In case of amino acid, instead of the OH, it is the NH3 plus group. If the NH3 group group is on the left, then it is L amino acid. If it is on the right, then it is D amino acid. In carbohydrates, you had found that the D carbohydrates, they are the most naturally occurring carbohydrates in this living world. And in case of amino acid, it is just the other way around. It is the L which is the most which is the amino acid which is present in the living world. So this is the structure of amino acid. Now if you look at the structure of amino acid once more in details, this is the alpha carbon. This carbon is known as alpha carbon, and this R group can be anything. This can be any group, any organic group. It should be organic, of course, not metal ion attached. So carbon has four hands, one hand NH3, one hand H, one hand COO minus. So this is और द बेसिक स्ट्रक्चर ऑफ एन एमिनो एसिड। सो वी हैव रेड दैट 19 ऑफ देम आर अल्फा एमिनो एसिड एंड देर इज वन विच इज एन अल्फा इमिनो एसिड एंड दैट इज प्रोलीन। वी विल सी द स्ट्रक्चर वेरी सून। प्रोलीन इज नॉट एन अल्फा एमिनो एसिड, इट्स अ अल्फा इमिनो एसिड। अल्फा इमिनो एसिड। सो देर आर 20 स्टैंडर्ड एमिनो एसिड्स। And they are based, this 20 standard amino acid is determined on the basis of the side chain or R groups, which is different. The first group of amino acid is the hydrophobic aliphatic amino acids. They are hydrophobic, that means they don't like water, aliphatic straight chain, and they are amino acids, of course. So what are the alpha among them the smallest is glycine, GLY or G, simple structure. So let us look at glycine in more details. अच्छा, कैन यू टेल मी, कैन यू सी दिस स्ट्रक्चर विच आई एम ड्रॉइंग हियर, दिस वन?
यस सर, यस सर।
ओके ओके। सो इन ग्लाइसिन यू हैव एज इन एमिनो एसिड यू हैव अ NH3 ग्रुप एंड देन यू हैव अ कार्बोक्सिल ग्रुप COO-, एंड इंस्टेड ऑफ इन द आर इज H, द आर इज इक्वल टू the R is equal to H. So the what the R group is the H. So this is the structure of glycine. We are now only we forget about D amino acid. We are only talking about L amino acids. LAA. Now interesting among them is this alpha carbon is the very strangely this in glycine. In this case it is not. What is a chiral carbon? A chiral carbon is a carbon which is attached to four different groups. But glycine is not attached to four different groups. This is one group here, this is another group, but these two groups, these two H, they are the same. So glycine is achiral. So there is no L-glycine, there is no L-glycine, or there is no D-glycine. There is no L-glycine and there is no D-glycine. This is how glycine is the only amino acid which has got which is achiral. Apart from that, all the other amino acids in this group AJ. Amra, we talked about glycine, now we are going to alanine. In alanine, instead of this R group is CH3, NH3 plus, everything is same, only this is CH3 and therefore it is alanine, it's known as ALA or it's written as A. Then we come to valine. In valine it is CH3, valine V. Then we come across leucine. In leucine it is like this. In all these amino acids you see that this alpha carbon, this is attached to four different groups. Therefore, they are all chiral. And if the amino group is on the left side, then it is an L amino acid. Just remember this. And in carbohydrates, if the one further away from the carbonyl carbon, that is the aldehyde or ketone group, the chiral carbon, the OH, if it is on the right side, then it is D. So, by this you can make L and D. So, this is alanine. Now, let us look at isoleucine. Isoleucine has got a complex structure. You have the NH3 COO. You have the H here, and this is the R group. After isoleucine, methionine. Methionine is one which has one amino acid. Everything is same up to here. This part is the same of amino acid. This is the R group. But methionine has got a sulfur. And the important thing about methionine is that any protein, it starts with methionine. This is a basic rule that any protein, it starts with methionine. The translation starts with methionine. There are some one or two exceptions, but in general, anything starts with methionine. Now, if we go to the structure of proline, it's an amino acid. Funny thing about it, here you have H2N, not H3N plus. And this part is the same, only this part, instead of H3N here, you have H2N. And this group is attached. I can tell you one of my the way I can remember all the structures of all the amino acids. You can also do it. Only you will find a problem with remembering three of them. I can remember 17 of them perfectly well, but I cannot remember three of them. I always make mistakes. The first among them is your proline. I cannot remember this structure. I always make a mistake here. Another one is histidine. I also always make a problem with histidine. And another one is tryptophan. All these three amino acids, I cannot remember the structure. I can remember the structure of all of them. Oh, only just a special character. So if you write these structures three times by looking, and then you write it once again, you will find that you can write remember them for the whole of your life. It is not just knowing what is there, where, if you just remember, then it is very good. You will be able to remember it. It is not that tough that how will I remember so many structures. It is not at all tough, because you know that this part is the same everywhere. Only the R group you must remember, and you must remember the properties of the R group. Alanine you will never forget. It's only a CH3. And valine CH3 CH3 whole 2. So here CH2CH, the same valine group comes up. In case of leucine, the valine group comes up, only one additional CH2 group comes in after that. So like this, in isoleucine you can find it's just an isomer. The CH3 group is coming, one group comes over here, CH3, and one comes over here. And the CH2 is present over here. So it's just a movement of the CH3 group. So if you practice something like 3-4 times, if you write C and write, then you will remember it throughout your life. Nothing to worry about it. Now we go from the hydrophobic aliphatic amino acids, we go to the hydrophobic aromatic amino acids. Aromatic means there is a ring. Famous among them, phenylalanine. Phenylalanine has got, this part is the same, NH3COOH, you remember it like this. Only change is that it has got a CH2 group to which is attached a phenylalanine group. For simplicity, I normally, instead of drawing these bonds, I normally draw these as a resonance, a circle over here. So I have to remember there the double bond is resonating from here or there. I simply, instead of this, for simplicity, instead of this structure here, I draw it like this. I make it a zero here. So this will show that this bond is resonating, so you don't have to remember where the double bonds are. And on the top, I simply write a CH2 group here. And on top, the common region comes up on the top. So this is phenylalanine. Then the famous amino acid tyrosine, present in lots of amount, tyrosine and tryptophan in chicken, mutton. So this tyrosine has got a CH2 group over here and phenyl group here. That is, there is an OH group. The same phenylalanine, only if you add an OH over here, it becomes a tyrosine. The OH is added and it becomes tyrosine. I also draw it as a circle inside. I don't draw the bonds. And there is the CH2 and this is the common region. Tryptophan, I cannot remember. I tell you frankly, an honest confession. This part is the same. There is the CH2 is the same. And then here is the part where I don't remember. One thing which I find it problematic to remember myself. The others I can remember. Then, after that, because of these aromatic rings, they are called aromatic. So, we have the polar charged amino acid. Polar means this side BJP, one side BJP, one side Trinamool. It is not like if you have a whole circle, you have BJP, Trinamool, BJP, Trinamool all mixed. So this is not polar. So polarization means what BJP does. First thing which they do is the society is having a mixture of Hindus and Muslims. The first thing what they do is that they incite, one side you put the Hindus and one side you put the Muslim. This is known as polarization. Similarly, polarization in the case of chemistry, it means that on one side you put a minus charge, one side is plus charge. It's not that the charges are mixed. So this is on both the poles you have the two charges. So these amino acids are polarized. So if you look at the polarized amino acid, the first one is charged polarized, the positive. Let us talk about the positively charged polarized one. So this part is common. We are talking about arginine, also present in mutton, chicken. CH2, then NH, C double bond NH2. So here there is one extra positive charge. So this is a, and here you find the negative charge, COO minus. So one negative charge, one positive charge. So as if the charge is on one side, the charge is on the other side. It is polarized. So this is, but this is a positively charged amino acid. Positively charged amino acids are basic amino acids. The next positively charged amino acid is lysine. Arginine, lysine have more or less similar properties. Famous in histones. Arginine, lysine. This group comes that instead of this here, it is just an NH3 plus over here. So plus charge is here and minus charge. It's a positively charged. I can remember these two, but then comes the next amino acid whose structure I cannot remember. I cannot remember this structure of histidine. This structure comes and it's very complex. I cannot remember it. If you can remember it, you are a genius, but I cannot remember it. So, but this is also positively charged, but more or less neutrally positive. Then we come across to the acidic amino acids like aspartate. Aspartate. This part is the same, but you have a CH2 COO minus. So you have a COO minus here. So this is a negatively charged amino acid. Here you have one positive charge, two positive charge and one minus charge. So 2 minus 1 is equal to, you have a 1 positive charge. In this case, you have 1 negative charge, you have 1 negative charge, 2 negative charge and a positive charge. So you have minus 1 negative charge. So this is a, when you have a negative charge, it's an acidic amino acid. Because you are acidic, because it is proton seeking, nucleus seeking. So this is an acidic amino acid. And this is a arginine, is a basic amino acid. Similarly, you have serine. Serine is nothing, this part is the same, but you have only a CH2OHO, an alcohol group is there, ethanol group is attached to serine. Then threonine, that same thing, this part is the R. Now comes the aspargine. They are neutral amino acids here. Glutamine. So you can basically aspargine, glutamine in histones, you can find them a lot. So they are also these have got no positive negative charge here extra. So they are known as polar uncharged amino acid. So these are the structures of amino acids. Now let us go to what a peptide bond is. Two proteins are attached by a peptide bond. Here you are writing your the structure of an amino acid like this. Only thing is that the H and the COO minus has been changed, and here is your R group. This is the first amino acid, and this is the second amino acid. From here, a molecule of water comes out. CO. So what happens here is that this region reacts and a water molecule is removed. Result is this double bond stays as it is, CONH, and the bond formed in between is a peptide bond. So a bond which is formed in between with the removal of H2O, the CONH, it's the called the peptide bond. And water comes out. Like this, another attaches, then there are several peptide bonds which join the amino acids, like glycosidic bonds which join carbohydrates. The peptide bond has got a partial double bond nature. That is because it's a partial, it's neither, it is not that weak like a single bond and not that strong like a double bond. So it is something in between. Because the electron in this O, because the electron resonates and comes over here, and it takes a partial double bond nature. Again, it comes back over here. So it's just going from here to here, it's resonating. This is a phenomenon in organic chemistry known as resonance. The electrons don't share, stay at one place. And the CONH group, it is not a very flexible thing. This CONH peptide bond, this is a very rigid and planar group. So one hand you can have it in this direction, in the other hand you can have it in somewhat this direction. And the structure of the protein is based on the side group. If it is negative, it will repel, and this is negative, they will be, these two groups, they will be far away. They will be far. If it is plus and minus, then they will come closer. Interesting thing is that this unit is rigid. This particular unit is rigid. This unit is rigid. But if that unit is rigid, after this unit, this bond here and this bond over here, there is a free rotation about C alpha N and C alpha C. So this is the C alpha bond, C alpha N. So this unit actually, it moves. This rigid unit moves. Let's see if I can show, is there a better picture over here? I can show, if I can show it over here. See, here, have a look at this. This is the C alpha bond. This is the next carbon, and this is the नाइट्रोजन. सो दिस रीजन इज द सी ओ एन एच रीजन. दिस रीजन दिस रीजन सी ओ एन एच रीजन. सो द आर ग्रुप, दिस इज वन आर ग्रुप हियर. दिस ऑल्सो हैज गॉट अनदर आर ग्रुप अटैच्ड. सो यू कैन सी दैट दिस स्टेज एज वन यूनिट एंड दिस इज अनदर यूनिट एंड द एंगल इन विच इट मूव्स. One is known as this symbol and one is known as phi. One is epsilon and one is phi. One bond is known as C alpha N bond. It is known as phi bond. And this is known as C alpha C bond is known as psi bond. So the movement is known as phi bond and psi bond. So Ramachandran, what he did, he checked, he took an amino acid which has got all he took an rotation angles here. Here's the Ramachandran plot. He calculated between the, he took a long peptide which had got several amino acids and he calculated the phi, what is the phi angle between, say that this is one amino acid, a peptide bond to another amino acid, it is to another amino acid, because of the R group they are having a different structure shape. If they are if this R group of this and the R group of this, they are this is plus and this is minus, both of them will have an attraction and they will be close to each other. But if in that case, if this is plus and this is minus, then they will repel each other. In this case, you will find that they will be further away from each other rather than close to each other. They will repel each other away because two same charges will repel each other. So based on whether the next one will repel or attract, your protein will be folded like that. It's a something like, for example, if you have some space, if somebody is pushing you, you will where you are in a bus, a very crowded bus, and now you want to stand in that bus. So where if some there will be one person who is going to be keeping on pushing you. If that person pushes you away, you will be far away from that person. If that person is pulling you towards him, you will be near that person. So like this, but the basic structure will be because of this push and pull, because of what the R group is. If the R group is charged, then the charge group will, if it's the same charge, it will repel. If it's the opposite charge, it will repel, pull. So by this mechanism, the structure of an amino acid can be, a structure of a protein has been made because of the R group of the amino acid. So Ramachandran did this and he made a plot phi and of all the amino acids, and he made a such a similar plot which comes out like this. This is known as the Ramachandran plot. So what Ramachandran took over here, he took a polyalanine. So what he had, what he had, he took a poly-L-alanine. So several alanine molecules were joined by peptide bonds. Several of them. And he calculated the angles everywhere here. He calculated the bond angles in the peptide bond. The phi and the psi. CN and CC, the angles were calculated. After he calculated these angles, he found out he could predict the structure of a protein, whether the protein could be an whether the protein can be a alpha helix or a beta pleated sheet. Now, what is alpha helix and what is beta pleated sheets? Let us go to the next part. We come to the primary structure of an amino acid. Let us go to what is the so we now come to structure of proteins. We finish the work of amino acid and peptide bonds. Now we go to proteins. Structure of proteins or polypeptides. So, the primary structure of the protein as I'm increasing this one moment. I'm just hold on a moment. I'm having a bit of a problem with the mobile, but it's fine. I mean, I can work with it. Okay. So, the primary structure in a protein is the linear sequence of amino acids as joined together by peptide bonds. So this means R1 first amino acid, second amino acid, third amino acid, fourth amino acid, fifth amino acid. So maybe this is methionine, this is valine, this is isoleucine, this is arginine. So this straight structure, when you dictate one after the other, you're not talking about the structure, how it turns and twists, or what is far away from each other. You're simply stop talking about what is after one another, the linear sequence, straight sequence. That is the primary structure of a protein. You can call it a polypeptide also. So, also included in the primary structure are location of covalent bonds, primarily disulfide bonds. Now, what are disulfide bonds? Let us have a look. This is one cysteine molecule. This is the second cysteine molecule, one and two. Now, here you see an SH group. Here too you see another SH group. Now, when an oxidation takes place, these two hydrogen go out and a SS bond is formed. This bond is known as disulfide bond. This SS bond is known as disulfide bond. Now, what is the significance of this disulfide bond? So, this is let us talk about a protein 1, 2. This has got, say, a disulfide bond, an SH here, the cysteine. This is another thing. This is another thing. And this is an SH bond. Okay. Now, If a disulfide bond is formed here, now how will the protein then look? It will essentially form a disulfide bond like this, and the protein will turn. So the structure which was straight like this, because of a disulfide bond here and here joining, it will become like this. It will turn. So the protein will fold. So this is the this is the significance of disulfide covalent bonds. So whenever there is a cysteine, there is a chance that these two, the protein will fold like this. So for example, if you face oxidative stress, your proteins which are separate in a reduced form SH with hydrogen, suddenly they become oxidized and form a disulfide bond and they join together. If they are an enzyme, the enzyme will lose activity. So this is the primary structure. Now we go to the secondary structure. Let us see this picture. And secondary structure, structure, it consists of, we talk about alpha helix and beta sheet. So if an alpha, if the amino acid, if the R group of the amino acid, because of the it's charged or whether it's uncharged or for whatever reason, this amino acid, they maintain, if because of the R group, whether they're charged, uncharged or whatever type of charge, they make a structure like a helix, like this. 3.6 amino acid per turn, 0.5 nanometer between this region and this region, 100 degrees per residues, 50 nanometer. So if it makes a position like this, this is known as, this is the alpha helix. This is because, this alpha helix is because of the R group. And the beta sheet. So if the protein makes a structure like this, this is alpha helix. In beta sheet, it comes like this. Then there is a beta bend, a region. Again, it goes up like this. Amino acid, again, it goes on the top. There is another bend like this. It again comes up like this, makes a bend, again comes up. If it takes this type of structure, a barrel shaped structure, this is known as beta sheet. So if the direction is from this direction, then it is beta. If it is beta dash, it's in the other way around. Like the first one is coming down, the second one is coming up. If it happens the other way around, first one comes up, second one comes this, just the other way around. This is the beta dash sheet. Alpha dash sheet is, if the helix is not right-handed, if it is in the left-handed, then it is alpha dash. But don't worry, only think about both are alpha, alpha sheets, alpha and beta. So this is the primary and the secondary structure of a protein. Next, we come to the another, there's a tertiary structure. So before we go to, we revise once more. First, you have a linear straight chain of amino acid. Maybe because of disulfide bonds, they sometimes turn like this. Now again, if the sequence of this region, the amino acids, they prefer to form alpha helix, you may find this region forming an alpha helix. And it bends because of this alpha helix. And then you have a beta sheet coming like this, like this. So you may have a protein which is an alpha helix. Suddenly it comes, there is a break of a protein like amino acid like proline. It breaks an alpha helix, and then suddenly you have the structure coming like this. This little region where it bends, it's known as beta bend. Then again it comes like this. So you have an alpha helix structure, then you have a beta sheet structure. So in the same protein you have two types of secondary structures, and you also have a primary structure. Maybe this is disulfide bond works. Now this is one polypeptide chain. There can be another polypeptide chain, and you have a beta sheet coming, one coming here, one coming up, coming down, coming up. So beta sheet, we are talking about this. So you have this structure, and now if there can be a hydrogen bonding between, this is one polypeptide, one protein, this is the second protein. So they can be hydrogen bonded among each other. Hydrogen bonding takes place, for example, like in water. You have a, this is, say for example, this is water, H2O. Now, for example, there is another H2O molecule here. These, over here, there is a bond known as hydrogen bond which is formed. Because this is slightly delta negative, this the oxygen is very electron seeking, it becomes slightly electron negative, and because of this, this is a very strong bond. You have, the water doesn't evaporate, it holds together as a liquid because of these hydrogen bonding. It's in a liquid state. If you boil them, these hydrogen bonds break and the water evaporates up, boils and goes away as vapors. But if it's in the liquid state, these hydrogen bonding, it holds the water. It's a water type of bonding. It holds the compound together. So this thing, it can happen. Say this is one polypeptide. This is polypeptide 2. It can happen. Hydrogen bonding can happen between among two. And these two can stay together. This is one polypeptide. This is two polypeptides. So in this tertiary, this is the tertiary structure. In the third tertiary structure, you may have two different polypeptides attached to each other. Tertiary structure can also be that even in the same molecule, from one group here and one group here, like a disulfide bond, you can have a hydrogen bond over here also. You can have a hydrogen bond here also. So this is the tertiary structure of a protein. Now let us go to the this is where it goes. So look at this picture. You have, because of this, this is one polypeptide, this is two polypeptide. Because these two polypeptides are coming together, this is the tertiary structure. Now the quaternary structure. So proteins containing one or more polypeptide chain such as hemoglobin exhibit a fourth level of protein structure known as quaternary structure. This level of structure refers to the spatial arrangements of the polypeptide subunits and the nature of interactions between them. The interactions may be covalent like disulfide bonds or non-covalent like electrostatic forces like hydrogen bonding, hydrophobic interactions, etc. So, you know, hemoglobin has got four subunits. Two are alpha, two are two units are beta. So if I draw it, these are two alphas. And I draw two betas like this. The heme, of course, is the heme center is located in center. Iron is there in the center, Fe. Fe, it's iron, it's in the, it binds to oxygen. So there are four arms which bind to four molecules. So basically, this type of structure is known as the quaternary structure, where if there were two alphas joining, then this would have been all, we could have talked them as a tertiary structure. But there are two different polypeptides joining now here. Now this becomes a quaternary structure. So there are some forces which stabilizes them. You have to read among them the electrostatic forces, like Van der Waals forces, hydrogen bonds, hydrophobic forces. This is an interesting thing. What are hydrophobic forces? Hydrophobic effect. So you have water and you have oil. Water and oil repel each other. So the oil molecule inside the water, they are water hating. They will just go and cluster in the center. The water will be outside. So they are hydrophobic. But if you have ghee over here and you have butter and ghee will mix. So two organic forces, they will hydrophobic. Both of them, ghee hates water, butter also hates water. So ghee and butter, they will, when you heat them, both of them will mix. But water will not mix. So both of them are hydrophobic. So hydrophobic, bhai bhai. So both of them, they come and stay together. They have an interaction among them. Similarly, hydrophilic, they will also have a similar. Water will love water seeking. For example, alcohol and water, they will mix perfectly well. But your oil and water will not mix. Oil and petrol will mix because both are oil, different types of things. But it is like both of them are hydrophobic, and hydrophobic and hydrophobic will mix. So this is how. And the other one which I have talked about is disulfide bonds. Now one last thing which I would like to go is, what is a Zwitterion? So the Zwitterion, this is a Zwitterion. If the pH is neutral for that particular amino acid, you have an NH3 plus over here and a COO minus over here. So the charges are balanced and it's Zwitterion. If the pH of the medium is low, that is, there is lots of H plus, there is very much H plus, this will of course have the H plus, and the COO minus will not stay. The H will get attached to it. So in an acidic medium, it is positive, low pH, because the hydrogen has taken away this minus charge, and that this minus charge remains. The charge of it is plus 1. If it is the pH is high, there is less hydrogen, what that media does, it takes away the hydrogen from here, NH2. NH3 plus becomes NH2. And of course, it is not, it takes the hydrogen away from here also in high pH. So you have a net charge of minus 1. This is known as, this is the change which takes place. And this, the balanced one is known as Zwitterion. Different amino acids at different pHs, they have got, they form Zwitterion at different pHs. It need not be neutral. Some acidic amino acids may have a pH the zwitterion formed coming here, some may have it over here. So different amino acids at different pHs, they form, they can be either acidic or basic, cation or anion. So this is the last thing which I wanted to mention. And